leave the stage.
Yes. Sorry.
Next the speaker, Yedida Koric. I hope you're okay. Yeah. He's a doctoral candidate in Talmud at Tel-Aviv University, currently writing her dissertation on lineage and intimate persons in rabbinic teachers, and MA thesis completed at Tel-Aviv University, did with the category of the first kind of Jew in rabbinic literature. Yedida holds a Bachelor of Arts in Talmudic and Classics from Frederick University.
Thank you. There are handouts in your briefcase that were prepared ahead of time. And I have one extra handout.
No, also in the bags. Your handouts also in the bags.
Everyone has.
Yes, everyone's in the, they're in the briefcases. I have one extra one. There aren't so many sources, and I'm going to read them out loud, so it's great. Religious family law generally poses an interesting intersection between the fields of law and religion. This is especially apparent in the rabbinic corpus. A unique aspect of rabbinic family law is the category of the mazir. Usually translated as bastard, the status of the mazir is more particular, and for the purposes of this paper, I won't translate it. The obscure term mazir appears only twice in the Hebrew Bible. The first occurrence is in Deuteronomy 23, in a list of people who are prohibited to enter the congregation of the Lord. This is source number one. In addition to men with deformed sexual organs and Ammonites and Moabites, no mazir shall be admitted into the congregation of the Lord. None of his descendants, even in the 10th generation, shall be admitted into the congregation of the Lord. Although the biblical passages don't provide enough clues to define this mazir, ancient Jewish readers agreed that a mazir is the product of illicit sexual relations. However, they differ on the particular relations that create one. In rabbinic literature of the first two centuries, Tanaitic literature, we find two possibilities. The less familiar one is that a mamzer is the child of a Jewish mother and a non-Jewish father. The more well-known position, current to this day, connects the mamzer to the prohibited and abhorrent sexual acts of Leviticus 18, incest and adultery. Ancient readers also contended with the prescription of mamzerim from the congregation of the Lord. What is this body exactly? Is it a specific arena, or are mamzerim simply expelled from the community? In Tanaitic literature, this prohibition is relatively limited in scope. Mamzerim are prohibited from marrying Jews of proper descent. Tanaitic literature seems to limit the prohibition on a rhetorical level as well. The Tosefta stresses that male mamzerim are fully obligated in the commandments and may perform them on behalf of the community. The Mishnah suggests a mamzer could be a scholar of Torah. Almost all Tanaitic sources address the mamzer from a strictly legal lens. Scholars have even noted a striking similarity between a passage from the Mishnah on laws of personal status and Roman legislation on illegitimate offspring. Although the scope of influence is debatable, the rhetoric of Tanaitic literature places the mamzer in the sphere of the law of persons. Both in rhetoric and substance, in most Tanaitic sources, the mamzer lacks any social stigma or metaphysical blemishes. Some sources, however, reveal another dimension to the mamzer. These sources do not confine the status to the legal sphere alone. In what follows, I'll discuss a passage that diverges from the characteristic vocabulary of Tanaitic texts on mamzerim. The Tosefta records a dispute between Rabbi Yosef and Rabbi Meir whether netinim and mamzerim will be pure in the future to come. This is source number two. Netinim and mamzerim will be pure in the future to come. The words of Rabbi Yossi. Rabbi Meir says, they will not be pure. Rabbi Yossi said to him, but it says, I will sprinkle pure water on you, and you shall be purified. Rabbi Meir said to him, from all of your impurities and from all of your idolatries. Rabbi Yossi said to him, what does it teach saying, I shall purify you, even from the state of Netinut and from the state of Mamzer? The Netin is a category appended to the Mamzer throughout Tanaitic literature. It seems that in this passage as well, the Netin is secondary, and so my discussion will focus on the mamzer. There are two unique elements in this passage. The first is the discussion of mamzerim in the context of the future to come. The rabbis, along with many of the ancients, were concerned with the end time. The future to come appears over 50 times in Tanelic literature, and yet only two other appearances address matters of halakha, pointing to the possibility that mamzerim contain a thicker level of significance. Moreover, the center of the debate is whether mamzerim will be pure in the future to come. This suggests the assumption that in present times, mamzerim are impure. This language is surprising. On the one hand, the expected and prevalent terminology regarding mamzerim would be valid and invalid, or prohibited and permitted. On the other hand, this language doesn't fit into the usual frameworks of purity laws, for the mamzer is not impure in the ritual sense. Several other Tanaitic sources use purity language to discuss mamzerim. I cannot discuss them here, but my analysis of the Tosefta will shed light on them as well. The few scholars who address this passage explain the purity language as a metaphor for the legal process of legitimation. They focused on Rabbi Yose's position and treated it more as a policy statement for the present. If mamzerim will be legitimate to the end of days, we don't have to be so strict about them today. Later rabbis in Babylonia seem to have read this passage in this way. The Talmudim record a Babylonian Amoraic tradition that the law follows Rabbi Yose. Although this reading reconciles our passage with the rest of Tanaitic literature, it doesn't account for its unique language and context. Moreover, scholars did not address the important proof text that Rabbi Yose offers for his position. Ezekiel 36 foretells that God will sprinkle pure waters on Israel to purify them of all their impurities that they contracted by grave sins. The incorporation of this verse and the powerful image of God ritually purifying the mamzerim requires our attention. In what follows, I will engage the purity language, the vision of the end of days, and the passage from Ezekiel on a more substantial level, and show that these provide fruitful results for a deeper understanding of the rabbinic mamzer, suppressed foremost by the rabbis themselves. With the help of previous studies on biblical and post-biblical categories of impurity, as well as texts found at the Dead Sea, composed during the first centuries before and during the Common Era, I hope to illuminate our passage from the Tosefta, and in return, this passage will reveal an ideological divide between rabbinic and sectarian perceptions of the human condition at large. Jonathan Kluwans distinguished between two types of impurity in the Hebrew Bible: ritual impurity and moral impurity. Ritual impurity is derived from bodily sources, such as corpses or fluxes. It is highly contagious to people or objects that the impure person encounters, but it is easily resolved with a purification rite. Moral impurity, on the other hand, is contracted from grave sins, such as murder and sexual violations. It does not ritually defile people or objects, but it defiles the land and the temple. It is not contagious, but there is no way that humans can resolve the defilement, which eventually expels them from the land. Thus we read in the end of the list of abhorrent sexual practices in Leviticus 18. This is source number 3. Do not defile yourselves in any of those ways, for it is by such that the nations that I am casting out before you defile themselves. Thus the land became defiled, and I called it to account for its iniquity, and the land spewed out its inhabitants. The distinction between these two categories is helpful in discussing impurity in post-biblical sources as well. But the implementation of these categories is not neat, for the Second Temple period saw new practical and ideological developments in the field of impurity. One of them is the emergence of a new type of impurity that Christine Hayes called genealogical impurity. This reflects a new perception of the Gentiles and their lineage in certain works from the Second Temple period. Hayes places the impurity of the mamzer in this context, based on the position that a mamzer is a child of a Jewish mother to a non-Jewish father, thus genealogically impure. However, I will suggest that the impurity of mamzerim and their possible purification is better understood considering the other rabbinic definition of the mamzer as the product of the prohibited unions in Leviticus 18. Another development in the field of impurity after the Bible is what Yair Furstenberg defined as a reification of moral impurity. In his words, this is the embodiment of moral impurity in tangible objects. I suggest that we understand the ascription of impurity to the mamzer in this way as well. In Leviticus 18, the sexual violations defile both the perpetrators and the land. It seems that the rabbis viewed the offspring of these violations, mamzerim, as defiled as well. Mamzerut is thus not merely a legal status of illegitimacy, but it is the embodiment of abomination and of moral impurity. The mamzer's impurity is not contagious in the ritual sense, but it cannot be cleansed by humans either. It clings to the mamzer forever and to all of his descendants. This is the context of the dispute between Rabbi Yossi and Rabbi Meir on whether the divine purification in the end of days will resolve the impurity of mamzerim as well. The key that connects the mamzer's impurity to the future to come in the Tosefta is Ezekiel. That's source number 4. The second half of Ezekiel 36 is closely related to Leviticus 18 and tells of the abominable acts that Israel performed, which defiled the land and brought about their expulsion, just as Leviticus warned them. However, Ezekiel offers a resolution to this situation, a future divine purification that will rid Israel of their sinful impurity. I will sprinkle pure water upon you, and you shall be clean. I will purify you from all your impurities and from all your fetishes. In addition to sprinkling the pure water, God will give the people a new heart and a new spirit, God's spirit. Kluang deliberates whether this passage is figuratively describing God's forgiveness in ritual terms, or if Ezekiel is envisioning an actual divine purification. Regardless, Kluang shows that this passage emphasizes the human dependency upon God to bring about the absolution for moral impurity. Another significant biblical passage describing God as purifying from sin is Psalm 51, and that's source number 5. Purge me with hyssop, so I shall be pure, says the poet, an individual sinner. This refers to the same ritual that Ezekiel describes, the sprinkling of the pure waters. The poet presents a unique argument to mitigate his responsibility. Indeed, I was born with iniquity. With sin my mother conceived me. The poet's sins result from his nature. His inception was sinful, and so he sins as well. The poet continues with a request of transformation and forgiveness that resemble Ezekiel again. He asks God for a pure heart and a steadfast spirit, and to not take his Holy Spirit away from him. These two biblical passages seem to stand at the foundation of the construction of another new type of impurity that is present in several of the scrolls. Gudrun Holtz defined this impurity as a constitutional impurity embedded in humankind, the human state being conceived in sin and being confined by earthly bodies is impure and sinful. This idea has many manifestations in the Qumran library. One of the strongest formulations appears several times in the Hodayot hymns, and this is source number 6. I am a creature of clay, fashioned with water, a foundation of nakedness, and a source of impurity, a furnace of iniquity, and a structure of sin, a spirit of error, deprived of knowledge, terrified by your just judgment. Two of these epithets are taken from the semantic field of sexual transgressions, a foundation of nakedness and a source of impurity. In other hymns, the author describes himself as being in a state of iniquity or impurity from his mother's womb and conceived in guilt of unfaithfulness. These descriptions seem to be expanded and exaggerated forms of Psalm 51 and reflect an existential kind of impurity rooted in one's inception. The Hodayot hymns attribute purification to God's great mercy. When he brings the elect to join the sect, he bestows kindness upon them and purifies them with the Holy Spirit. According to Menachem Kister, this description evokes the divine purification in Ezekiel 36. The Holy Spirit might also be alluding to Psalm 51. The Qumranic community rule, this is source number 7, posits that God's elect will be purified from constitutional impurity in the end of days, after separating the evil spirit from their impure bodies and purifying them with the Holy Spirit. He will sprinkle over him the spirit of truth like waters of lustration, in order to cleanse him from all the abominations of deceit and from the defilement of the spirit of impurity. This passage is clearly evoking the divine sprinkling of waters in Ezekiel 36. As Holtz noted, this purification is not from specific sins as per Ezekiel, but from the sinful and impure human condition. Returning to the Tosefta, I suggest that Rabbi Yossi is participating in the ancient interpretation of Ezekiel 36 and Psalms 51, with one adjustment. Instead of reading the universal human impurity into these biblical passages, Rabbi Yossi provides a more specific understanding of the constitutional impurity and identifies it with the mamzer. There is a type of impurity that is tied to sinful conception, but not all humans are impure from the womb. Only mamzerim, whose parents sinned when conceiving them. It is therefore mamzerim who require divine purification. According to Rabbi Yossi, in the end time, God will purify them. Rabbi Meir's position is more oblique. Perhaps a way of incorporating him into this scheme is that he sees mamzerim as parallel to the unchosen ones in the Quran worldview, who will perish in the end of days. Rabbi Meir views mamzerim as beyond repair, and they won't receive purification, even in the future to come. Applying these biblical passages and the constitutional impurity to the mamzer enables the rabbis to release humanity at large of the sinfulness and impurity associated with the human condition. The majority of Tannaitic literature relates to the mamzer as an invalid marital partner for normative Jews, and that's it. The mamzer is a flat category and relevant only in the context of the law of persons. However, several rabbinic sources, like the one I just discussed, reveal a richer and darker approach. This passage displayed both unique terminology and context to discuss mamzeri, using purity language and invoking the future to come. Moreover, Rabbi Yossi ties these two elements to an image of God sprinkling purifying waters on the mamzeri, based on Ezekiel's prophecy for the end of days. This level of engagement with the mamzer should be taken seriously. Reading the Tosefta in light of other ancient Jewish texts and conceptions of impurity reveals a shared religious lexicon and similar interpretive moves that diverge from biblical models of impurity based on a combined reading of Ezekiel 36 and Psalms 51. This produces a new type of impurity in both corpuses. Where the Tosefta and the Qumran texts differ is on the application of this impurity. In the Qumran sect, humankind is conceived in impurity and sinfulness. For the rabbis, this impurity is more concrete and specific. Only mamzerim are impure, because only their parents sinned when conceiving them. Rabbi Yossi and the Qumran sect read the divine purification in Ezekiel as a solution to their respective innovative impurities. The impure cannot bring about their own purification. Rather, they are dependent upon God to release them of their impurity with the sprinkling of pure waters in the future to come. While Rabbi Yossi and Rabbi Meir differ with regards to the future purification of mamzerim, both participate in a broader rabbinic move to free humanity at large of sinfulness and impurity by pinning them to the mamzer. This cultivates a different mode of standing before God. But it is the salvation for the many at the expense of the few. The individual selected to carry what was before the human condition now became the embodiment of sin, subjected to normative strictures which seemed harsh even to later grandmas. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations for your presentation and questions.
Thank you. I wonder if you can say a little bit more about this concept of impurity that comes from the human condition that you find in the Qumran writings. I mean, there are two elements here. There is the human condition, and there is the conceiving or the being born out of a sexual intercourse. So, sometimes it sounds like the human intercourse is not the central there. It's about human condition in general that is low. But when you go to talk about the rabbis, you seem to focus on whether or not sexual relationship is a positive or negative thing. And it's not only that you purify, you release all humanity or all Israelites from a being considered sinful, but you also release the sexual act in the normal and normative condition from being considered sinful. So if you can say something about this.
Yeah, so thank you very much. It's a very good point. So I didn't come up with this idea of the constitutional impurity. This is something that Gudrun Holtz wrote about in an article, and Menachem Kister also writes about this. And truthfully, it has different manifestations in different parts of the Qumran library. So in some texts, or even in one scroll, that sometimes it seems that it's more tied to just the physicality of the body. And other formulations seem to tie it more to being impure from the womb and from conception, and something about conception and birth as something that brings about this impurity. Also, there's the dualism, or it's sort of combined this idea of impurity together with an idea of sinfulness, which it sometimes come together and sometimes are separate from each other. But I would say in general that this sort of fits the general Qumran worldview that that in general humanity and or everyone is under spirit is impure and sinful and under the dominion of impure spirits that lead them astray, and that only joining the sect can free you. Joining the sect frees you of all of this. So it's sort of. You can see all the elements separate, but then also they can sort of come together.
Thank you.
Please. First, I mean, not related, but there is an opinion which is brought by that medieval commentary of has read that there was like a race of people.
Yes. Yeah.
This, but also, I was wondering if you, it's possible to read the Torah Septa, and basically the verse of what you said, that when you see, when he cites that verse, you know, maybe a mayor then rejects it by saying, no, this only applies to Mikol Tumotichem, which has not applied to a mamzer, that's not a form of tuma, of a purity. To which Rabbi Yossi then comes back and says, no, when the verse says, I will purify you, that comes to even include these two people. So he may be saying, meaning in addition to the rest of the humanity, which has to be purified, even they also will be purified. So,
right, so
I mean, I think you agree with that way.
You could, but Rabbi, but the first statement that Rabbi Meir says is, they will not be pure. Which seems to imply that he agrees that they're impure, and that so they both agree that they're impure. But just Rabbi Meir says they will not be pure. So I'm not sure.
So what then is the basis of his rejection of citing, you know, from all your appearance?
So the it seems that he reads Ezekiel more in the context of the purification will be of literal, the moral of the regular biblical moral impurity of the defilement of the land and of the sins themselves, but it won't purify the products of the products of those sins. The ones are even just beyond repair.
I guess the quintessential example of constitutional impurity would be the doctrine of the original sin, because it doesn't fit, you know, into the categories of ritual purity or even moral purity. In the sense that it extends to further generations. And it's not genealogical impurity, so it's constitutional impurity. Do you think there is a connection, perhaps by way of expansion, between the doctrine of the original sin and applying this this model that applies in rabbinic literature to Manzerim, which once again doesn't neatly fit in this conception of genealogy or moral impurity, through the lens of the constitutional impurity? Perhaps or it could work the other way around. Maybe the rabbis are limiting it, or maybe the early Christians are expanding this conception of a mamzerut to humankind.
Yeah. The concept of original sin is complicated and requires another. I mean, the genealogy of what is the idea of original sin? So I'm not sure the Qumran segment, you don't have to have a concept of original sin in order to think about the human condition just at large as impure and sinful. It doesn't have to have been an original fall or an original sin. It could just be that this is, original sin implies that it has the whole Eden, and then there was a fall, and then, so I'm not sure that the Quran, this could be connected and can easily be
right, but if you put Qumran on the side for a minute, yeah, and look at the rabbinic concept of mamzerut, the mamzer originated in sin, but it's not his or her sin,
right?
It is a sin that occurred previously.
Yeah, right.
So it doesn't really fit into this, you know, the biblical idea in age and Ezekiel of moral impurity. And it also doesn't fit into genealogical impurity, per se, at least not in the sense of, if we follow genealogical impurity, right, to the extreme, we'll have a case where, and Ezra and Nehemiah, right, there are no converts, conversion is impossible,
right,
because Gentiles have
right,
this,
right.
Okay, so this idea of constitutional impurity, right, is germane to this, to understanding what the mamzer is. So perhaps if we look at the rabbinic concept of mamzer, the way you described
yeah.
it, as a form of constitutional impurity, and compare that to the Christian doctrine, I don't know if it's via Qumran or not, would you think there might be any connections there?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's an interesting group to explore. But I do think that it's an interesting route to explore, but it's also possible to just say that there were developments in the concept of moral impurity that Yair Fusenberg shows that it became associated with objects and being reified, and that can also be a way to the more sincere explain.
So, please, last question, please. My question is a little bit unfair because it's a question that's developing through different talks, but I think your talk is really an opportunity to, your topic here is an opportunity, maybe a more obvious or bigger opportunity to think about this question of law or religion, because it kind of introduces, you know, thematically some kind of idea of spirituality, even if just from the use of, the rabbi's use of Psalm 51. My word or our word, spirituality, not theirs, obviously. But and so you know, so this is kind of tying your talk a little bit to David's. But how do you see that? Do you see that at all? That here, where the rabbis are giving us law very clearly, and they're debating the legal status, they're debating the legal outcome. That there's this spiritual kind of injection here. Does that affect how you see it vis-a-vis the others?
Yeah. So I think it's interesting. I don't. I prefer to not use the term spiritual, just because I don't know enough about.
And that's exactly why I use it. It's a terrible, vague word.
Right, yeah.
Right, but it breaks us away from law.
Yeah, I prefer the term metaphysical, but what I think is actually interesting in using the term spiritual is that in Qumran there is a strong emphasis in all of these texts on the spirit of God. Right. In addition with purification, there will be a spirit of God will grant his spirit, and that appears in, taken from Psalms and from Ezekiel. And what's interesting is the rabbis, even their sort of spiritual or metaphysical discussion sort of pushes, doesn't really address the spirit of God. They take from Ezekiel only the sprinkling of the pure waters. So so that's also, even when they're talking about metaphysical issues, they're using legal language, using legal constructs and images to talk about that, and they don't really use the spiritual. So that's also another interesting.
What does that mean to you? I mean, so they are speaking spiritually, metaphysically, whatever. They're speaking in some way that in their language of the law. I mean, are you breaking down that category?
So I think they're using legal terms, and even the formulation, right? Whether they will be pure in the future to come, they won't be pure in the future to come. That already sounds like a sort of a legalistic kind of discussion, but it's just jarring. It's jarring because it's there. So it's this I guess combination of discourses or more to think about.
Thank you for this.